Macmillan Audio presents The Copenhagen Trilogy, Childhood, Youth, Dependency, by Tove Ditlevsen. Read for you by Stine and Wintlev.
Childhood, Youth, Dependency, The Copenhagen Trilogy, by Tove Ditlevsen. Read by Stine Wintlev. Childhood. 1. In the morning, there was hope. It sat like a fleeting gleam of light in my mother's smooth black hair that I never dared touch. It lay on my tongue with the sugar and the lukewarm oatmeal I was slowly eating while I looked at my mother's slender, folded hands that lay motionless on the newspaper, on top of the reports of Spanish flu and the Treaty of Versailles. My father had left for work, and my brother was in school. So my mother was alone, even though I was there, and if I was absolutely still and didn't say a word, the remote calm in her inscrutable heart would last until the morning had grown old and she had to go out to do the shopping in Istilgil like ordinary housewives. The sun broke over the gypsy wagon as if it came from inside it, and Scabby Hens came out with bare chest and a wash basin in his hands. When he had poured the water over himself, he put out his hand for a towel and Pretty Lily gave it to him. They didn't say a word to each other. They were like pictures in a book when you quickly turn the pages. Like my mother, they would change in a few hours. Scabby Hens was a Salvation Army soldier and Pretty Lily was his sweetheart. In the summer, they packed a bunch of little children into the green wagon and drove into the country with them. Parents paid 1 krone a day for this. I had gone myself when I was 3 years old and my brother was 7. Now I was 5 and the only thing I could remember from the trip was that Pretty Lily once set me out of the wagon, down in the warm sand, in what I thought was a desert. Then the green wagon drove away from me and got smaller and smaller, and inside of it sat my brother, and I was never going to see him or my mother again. When the children came back home, they all had scabies. That's how Scabby Hens got his name. But Pretty Lily was not pretty. My mother was, though, on those strange and happy mornings when I would leave her completely in peace. Beautiful, untouchable, lonely, and full of secret thoughts I would never know. Behind her on the flowered wallpaper, the tatters pasted together by my father with brown tape, hung a picture of a woman staring out the window. On the floor behind her was a cradle with a little child. Below the picture, it said, "Woman awaiting her husband home from the sea." Sometimes my mother would suddenly catch sight of me and follow my glance up to the picture I found so tender and sad. But my mother burst out laughing and it sounded like dozens of paper bags filled with air exploding all at once. My heart pounded with anguish and sorrow because the silence in the world was now broken, but I laughed with her because my mother expected me to and because I was seized by the same cruel mirth as she was. She shoved the chair aside, got up, and stood in front of the picture in her wrinkled nightgown, her hands on her hips. Then, with a clear and defiant little girl voice that didn't belong to her in the same way as her voice did later in the day when she'd start haggling about prices with the shopkeepers, she sang, "Can't I sing whatever I wish for my tulle? Viselulle, viselulle, viselulle. Go away from the window, my friend. Come back another time. Frost and cold have brought the old beggar home again." I didn't like the song, but I had to laugh loudly because my mother sang it to amuse me. It was my own fault, though, because if I hadn't looked at the picture, she wouldn't have noticed me. Then she would have stayed sitting there with calmly folded hands and harsh, beautiful eyes fixed on the no man's land between us. And my heart could have still whispered "mother" for a long time and known that in a mysterious way she heard it. I would have left her alone for a long time so that without words she would have said my name and known we were connected to each other. Then something like love would have filled the whole world, and Scabby Hence and Pretty Lily would have felt it and continued to be coloured pictures in a book. As it was, right after the end of the song, they began to fight and yell and pull each other by the hair. And right away, angry voices from the stairwell began to push into the living room, and I promised myself that tomorrow I would pretend the wretched picture on the wall wasn't even there. When hope had been crushed like that, my mother would get dressed with violent and irritated movements as if every piece of clothing were an insult to her. I had to get dressed too, and the world was cold and dangerous and ominous because my mother's dark anger always ended in her slapping my face or pushing me against the stove. She was foreign and strange, and I thought that I had been exchanged at birth and she wasn't my mother at all. When she was dressed, she stood in front of the mirror in the bedroom, spit on a piece of pink tissue paper, and rubbed it hard across her cheeks. I carried the cups out to the kitchen, and inside of me, long, mysterious words began to crawl across my soul like a protective membrane. A song, a poem, something soothing and rhythmic and immensely pensive, but never distressing or sad, as I knew the rest of my day would be distressing and sad. When these light waves of words streamed through me, I knew that my mother couldn't do anything else to me because she had stopped being important to me. My mother knew it too, and her eyes would fill with cold hostility. She never hit me when my soul was moved in this way, but she didn't talk to me either. From then on, until the following morning, it was only our bodies that were close to each other. And, in spite of the cramped space, they avoided even the slightest contact with each other. The sailor's wife on the wall still watched longingly for her husband, but my mother and I didn't need men or boys in our world. Our peculiar and infinitely fragile happiness thrived only when we were alone together. And when I stopped being a little child, it never really came back, except in rare, occasional glimpses that have become even more dear to me now that my mother is dead and there is no one to tell her story as it really was. 2. Down in the bottom of my childhood, my father stands laughing. He's big and black and old like the stove, but there is nothing about him that I'm afraid of. Everything that I know about him, I'm allowed to know, and if I want to know anything else, I just have to ask. He doesn't talk to me on his own because he doesn't know what he should say to little girls. Once in a while, he pats me on the head and says, "Heh heh." Then my mother pinches her lips together and he quickly takes his hand away. My father has certain privileges because he's a man and provides for all of us. My mother has to accept that, but she doesn't do it without protest. "You could sit up like the rest of us, you know," she says, when he lies down on the sofa. And when he reads a book, she says, "People turn strange from reading. Everything written in books is a lie." On Sundays, my father drinks a beer and my mother says, "That costs 26 øre. If you keep at it like this, we'll end up in Sundholm." Even though I know Sundholm is a place where you sleep on straw and get salt herring 3 times a day, the name goes into the verse I make up when I'm scared or alone, because it's beautiful like the picture in one of my father's books that I'm so fond of. It's called Work a Family on a Picnic, and it shows a father and mother and their 2 children. They're sitting on some green grass and all of them are laughing while they eat from the picnic basket lying between them. All 4 of them are looking up at a flag stuck into the grass near the father's head. The flag is solid red. I always look at the picture upside down since I only get a chance to see it when my father is reading the book. Then my mother turns on the light and draws the yellow curtains even though it's not dark yet. "My father was a scoundrel and a drunkard," she says, "but at least he wasn't a socialist." My father keeps on reading, calmly because he's slightly deaf, and that's no secret either. My brother Ilvin sits and pounds nails into a board and afterwards pulls them out with pliers. He's going to be a skilled worker. That's something very special. Skilled workers have real tablecloths on the table instead of newspaper, and they eat with a knife and fork. They're never unemployed, and they're not socialists. Ilvin is handsome, and I'm ugly. Ilvin is smart, and I'm stupid. Those are eternal truths, like the printed white letters on the baker's roof down the street. It says, Politiken is the best newspaper. Once I asked my father why he read Socialdemokraten instead, but he just wrinkled his brow and cleared his throat while my mother and Ilvin burst into their paper laughter because I was so incredibly stupid. The living room is an island of light and warmth for many thousands of evenings. The four of us are always there, like the paper dolls up on the wall behind the pillars in the puppet theatre my father made from a model in Familiejournalen. It's always winter, and out in the world it's ice cold like in the bedroom and the kitchen. The living room sails through time and space, and the fire roars in the stove. Even though Ilvin makes lots of noise with his hammer, it seems like an even louder sound when my father turns a page in the forbidden book. After he has turned many pages, Ilvin looks at my mother with his big brown eyes and puts the hammer down. "Won't mother sing something?" he says. "All right," says my mother, smiling at him, and at once my father puts the book down on his stomach and looks at me as if he'd like to say something to me. But what my father and I want to say to each other will never be said. Ilvin jumps up and hands my mother the only book she owns and cares about. It's a book of war songs. He stands bending over her while she leaves through it, and though of course they don't touch each other, they're together in a way that excludes my father and me. As soon as my mother starts to sing, my father falls asleep with his hands folded over the forbidden book. My mother sings loudly and shrilly, as if dissociating herself from the words she sings. Mother, is it mother? I see that you have wept. You have walked far, you have not slept. I am happy now. Don't cry, mother. Thank you for coming, despite all this horror. There are many verses to all of my mother's songs, and before she reaches the end of the first one, Ilvin starts hammering again, and my father is snoring loudly. Ilvin has asked her to sing in order to avert her rage over my father's reading. He is a boy, and boys don't care for songs that make you cry if you listen to them. My mother doesn't like me to cry either, so I just sit there with a lump in my throat and look sideways down at the book. At the picture of the battlefield where the dying soldier stretches his hand up toward the luminous spirit of his mother, who I know isn't there in reality. All of the songs in the book have a similar theme, and while my mother is singing them, I can do whatever I want because she's so completely absorbed in her own world that nothing from outside can disturb her. She doesn't even hear it when they start to fight and argue downstairs. That's where Rapunzel with the long golden braid lives with her parents, who haven't yet sold her to the witch for a bunch of bluebells. My brother is the prince, and he doesn't know that soon he'll be blind after his fall from the tower. He pounds nails into his board and is the family's pride and joy. That's what boys are, while girls just get married and have children. They have to be supported, and they can't hope for or expect anything else. Rapunzel's father and mother work at Carlsberg, and they each drink 50 beers a day. They keep on drinking in the evening after they've come home, and a little before my bedtime, they start yelling and beating Rapunzel with a thick stick. She always goes to school with bruises on her face or legs. When they get tired of beating her, they attack each other with bottles and broken chair legs, and the police often come to get one of them. And then quiet finally falls over the building. Neither my mother nor my father likes the police. They think Rapunzel's parents should be allowed to kill each other in peace if they want to. They're doing the big shots' work, my father says about the police, and my mother has often talked about the time the police came and got her father and put him in jail. She'll never forget it. My father doesn't drink, and he's never been in jail either. My parents don't fight, and things are much better for me than for them when they were children. But
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.